When I get ready to show, okay. Oh.
Right. Hey, well, good evening. We're glad you're here. It's 6 o'clock, and we're going to go ahead and get started. This is our Summer in the Classics series, and Dr. Markos is going to be with us not only tonight, but also on August the 1st, and then the last Sunday night of August as well. And so we're thrilled about that. We need to advertise a little bit better an intimate night with Dr. Markos, I think. What a joy. If you want to move up a little bit closer, you're welcome to do that, and I think Dr. Markos is going to... There you go. And so anybody that would like to can join us for supper right afterwards. Just gather around the table and visit all the more. And so let me pray, and I'll turn it over to Dr. Markos. Father, we thank you so much for you and how creative you are and how you have also made us in your image to be creative. We thank you so much for your story that we're in, and how we can share that story in a multitude of different ways. I thank you for the ministry Dr. Markos has at HBU and literally around this nation. And just bless us tonight as we learn about Bunyan's The Pilgrim's Progress. In your name we pray, amen. Dr. Markos has a couple of books in the back, one children's story and another his latest one. I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Markos then.
Oh, the voice of God. And, well, I'll tell you what's really interesting. Let me just kind of move everything down here so it's closer. What's interesting is that that book I have, The Myth Made Fact, they just hired me to do the audiobook version, which I've never done before. I mean, I do speaking and all, but I've never done. And I just remembered the old days when I was reading out loud to my kids. And it's not really fictional, but I wanted to dramatize it. So whenever I read a scripture verse, and there's a lot of scripture verses in the book, I would switch into, you know, Cecil B. DeMille mode. The Lord saith. And so it was a lot of fun, but it's very, very exhausting. Now, let's begin with a poem, and we'll see afterwards who identifies the source of this. The road goes ever on and on, down from the door where it began. Now far ahead the road has gone, and I must follow if I can. Pursuing it with eager feet until it joins some larger way, where many paths and errands meet, and whither then I cannot say. Can you identify that? Does anybody know where that comes from? That comes from The Lord of the Rings. You recognize it? That's the old walking song that Bilbo taught his nephew Frodo, right? And I love it, and one of the reasons I love Lord of the Rings is it uses one of the most common metaphors in all literature, all around the world. And that's summed up in those three words, you've heard it many times, life is a road. I guess that's four words. Life is a road. Not just life is like a road. That would be a simile. Life is a road, and we are pilgrims. We are wanderers. We are sojourners, to use that beautiful old King James word, right? And behind so much of great literature is this idea that we are pilgrims on the road as we're going step by step closer to our destination. It underlies the Odyssey, right? The Odyssey is a pilgrimage in which Odysseus is trying to get home after being, oh, you're trying to get the lights? Am I messing you up there with the lights? I want to get a little closer here. So Odysseus is on a road, right? If you think of the Aeneid, that's the story of how Aeneas, a survivor of the Trojan War, founded what would become Rome and the Roman Empire. And most of that epic is a journey along a road. Now, you notice sometimes the road is this, sometimes it's a watery road, but it's still a road where you're moving from one place to the other. And I think you've all learned this, that when we're on a journey like that, that the journey is sometimes as important as the destination. We've heard that. I mean, these things are cliches, but they really are true. Life, I mean, what about the Bible? The Bible begins with Adam and Eve and the fall and the flood and the Tower of Babel, but the Bible really begins with the calling of Abraham, right? And Abraham is told by God to take to the road and go to a place. He doesn't even know what it looks like. a land flowing with milk and honey. That's beautiful. And he's on the road, right? And then that's Genesis. The next book, Exodus, is the word Exodus in Greek means a road out. And it's all about the Jews leaving Egypt and wandering in the wilderness, right? So it's about being on the road. What about the New Testament? Not only is Jesus very much a peripatetic minister, right? But also the whole book of Acts is on the road. Do you remember the figure? How many thousands of miles Paul travels in the book of Acts? It's like 3,000 miles. Some on foot, some by boat, most by foot though. All over the old Mediterranean world, right? Some of you have heard of Dante's Divine Comedy. That is also a journey. Hell, purgatory, and paradise, right? You've heard of Don Quixote, right? He goes to the road and becomes a knight, right? What about Huckleberry Finn? Right? All of these are being on the road. And of course, Lord of the Rings and many of the Chronicles of Narnia. In fact, some people mention that both Narnia and Lord of the Rings, all they ever seem to do is walk. Walking, and they eat a lot too. Walking, eating, on and on and on. But I think all people are drawn to this metaphor because that's really what life is like. And sometimes the road bends and we don't know where it goes, or it goes down like that and we're terrified and we face the dangers of the road and we look ahead to the end of the road. Now, literally speaking, when you're on the road, the dangers you face are physical. They could be thieves, right? They could be kidnappers. If you're on the sea, they could be pirates. If you're in a fairy tale, it could be a one-eyed cyclops trying to kill you, right? So we face all these dangers on the road. But there are also internal dangers, aren't they? Odysseus, if he's going to get home in the Odyssey, he not only has to survive the physical dangers of people that want to kill him, he also has to face what I would call the danger of the false homecoming. In other words, he has to keep focused on Penelope and Ithaca and his son Telemachus and not just stop and make something else his home. There's no less than three women that could easily be surrogate Penelopes: Circe, Calypso, and a girl named Nausicaa. All of them tempt him, but he continues on home. Right? The same thing, Dante's Inferno. He is literally geographically going through hell, but he's also going on a journey through his own sinful nature, right? We need to understand our own sinfulness before we seek a savior, right? I feel like I'm caught here. Okay, there we go. Now, the best book of all time that deals with the internal challenge is Pilgrim's Progress. And even though Pilgrim's Progress is written in terms of a geographic journey, right? A journey along a concrete physical road. The real journey that Christian, our pilgrim, goes on, the real journey, you may have noticed, is an internal one, right? Because when you're a Christian, yeah, sometimes you face external things, but most of us face internal things. The temptation to pride or lust, the temptation to despair, the temptation to just give up the journey. All of these things are inside of us, right? They're internal temptations. But that often makes them hard to get a hold on, as we would say. And so what John Bunyan did way back in the 17th century, he's writing just about the same time as John Milton is writing Paradise Lost, about 50 years after the King James Bible, so it's very King James in its English. We're talking about a generation or two after Shakespeare, right? The 17th century is what we call this. It's the high or the end of the Renaissance before the Enlightenment sets in. John Donne, George Herbert, I don't know if some of those names ring bells, but this is the great 17th century of England. It's the same century when, of course, the Puritans left and came to America, right? 1620, Plymouth Rock and all that stuff, right? Okay, what John Bunyan did is, in order to help us understand the internal challenges of the Christian walk, is he writes an allegory. Now, in an allegory, one thing stands for something else. It's a sort of a code, right? And one I guess, fancy word, one subgenre of the allegory is what we call the dream allegory. So you have a dream, and in the dream, each of the things you see and the people you meet represent something else, right? And if those of you who have started to read it, I wonder if you noticed how Bunyan keeps saying, "and then in my dream." I mean, if you're like me, I'm like, why do you keep breaking the third, we call that the fourth wall? Why do you keep reminding us? But maybe he wants to, you know, so he doesn't, we won't think he's a heretic making up a new book of Revelation or whatever. But he just keeps reminding us, in my dream, in my dream. But think about it. There are dream allegories in the Bible, aren't they? When Pharaoh has the dream of the seven fat cows and the seven skinny cows, right? And those cows are not important. Like, they don't have a personality. They're not a three-dimensional character. They simply represent 7 years of plenty followed by 7 years of famine. And Joseph, God allows him to interpret the meaning of the symbols in the dream allegory. Does anybody remember another pagan emperor having a dream that has to be interpreted? Hey, very good. Nebuchadnezzar's dream in Daniel 2, or is it 3? I think it's Daniel 2. He has the dream of the giant, right, with the four metals. Again, that's not a real giant. He doesn't have a character, right? He just is a stand-in for those four kingdoms, Babylon, Persia, Greece, Rome, and then the stone uncut by human hands that smashes the feet and the whole thing falls away and goes off like chaff in the wind, right? Now, the reason I want to make this clear is, and I think I might have spoken on this before, remember when I talked about Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe? Lewis was always very clear, it's not an allegory. Now, it has a Christian meaning, but it's not an allegory because it's not like Peter equals, I don't know, the Apostle Peter, and Lucy equals John. Now, Aslan is Christ, but he's not just a stand-in, he's the Christ of Narnia. Right? So, now, Lewis did write an allegory called The Pilgrim's Regress, which is an allegorical version of his testimony, right? And that's a pretty hard book to understand. And there, we don't have three-dimensional characters because we're not meant to, right? They're just standing in for something else. Now, why write an allegory? You write an allegory because when you take something internal and you externalize it, you make it concrete, now we can see it and learn from it and deal with it, right? And, you know, this whole idea of interpreting dreams that Freud picked up on, that's much older than Freud. That goes back to the Old Testament, right? The trouble with Freud is anything you see has to do with sex. It can't be anything else. It's got to be sex, right? Okay. Well, that's part of dreams, but there's more to that than dreams. So this is a dream allegory. And so don't look for interesting character development. They are, in a sense, cardboard characters, but they're representing different aspects of the Christian walk. You'll notice that fairly early on in the book, Christian is saved. This is not so much a book about salvation as it is what we would call the road of sanctification, staying true and being a pilgrim and continuing on in your walk. So what I'm saying is, this is a book that you can give to a non-believer, but this is even more meant for a believer because we all struggle with the kinds of things that Christian struggles with, right? Now, one of the reasons this book is so beloved, again, it renders concrete things that we can't quite see or smell or taste or touch. It puts them out there. It makes them physical and tangible. Palpable is another fancy word, and we'll never forget it. Let me just give you an example of something you'll never forget once you read it. And I wish I could give you page numbers. I can't even give you chapter numbers. It is impossible to find anything in this book. I mean, it took me forever to go back and find it. So anyway, I'll just read a few passages interspersed here to give you a sense of this. So Christian is in his town, you know, the city of destruction, right? And it's going to end at the celestial city, the sort of heavenly city that he's going to. But it all begins when evangelist, and he is just an evangelist, right? The evangelist speaks, and he says, "Then said evangelist, if this be thy condition," Christian. By the way, he's not called Christian until he becomes a Christian, right? He's just a person, but then eventually he will become what we call an everyman. We still use that word that embodies all Christians. So he says, "If this be thy condition, why standest thou still?" He answered, because I know not whither to go. Then he gave him, Christian, a parchment roll, and there was written within, Fly from the wrath to come. The man therefore read it, and looking upon Evangelist very carefully, said, Whither must I fly? Then said Evangelist, pointing with his finger over a very wide field, Do you see yonder wicker gate? The man said, No. Then said the other, Do you see yonder shining light? He said, I think I do. Then said Evangelist, Keep that light in your eyes and go up directly thereto, so shalt thou see the gate, at which, when thou knockest, it shall be told thee what thou shalt do. So I saw in my dream that the man began to run. Now, he had not run far, from his own door, but his wife and children, perceiving it, began to cry after him to return. But the man put his fingers in his ears and ran on, crying, Life! Life! Eternal life! So he looked not behind him, but fled towards the middle of the plain. That may be the most memorable moment, because what it does, what it renders concrete, is the urgency of the gospel, right? And if there's one thing we've lost, it is that urgency. And I like to talk to people from like a place like California or Australia, and I'll say, what is it like to be, okay, everything changed last year, but 5 years ago, you ask somebody, is it hard to be a Christian in California? And they'll tell you it is both easier and harder. It's easy because, until now, nobody's really actively persecuting you, but it's hard because the reason they don't persecute you is they don't take it seriously. Okay, you're a Christian, I'm a vegan. What's the difference, right? So there's no, and the same thing in Australia, there's no sense of urgency. And again, we live in a world where, you know, there's no urgency. And so this reminds us, when the call comes, this image of the man running with his fingers stuffed in his ear, crying out, yelling, we say, running off, captures what it takes to follow. And right now, we live in a noisy world, a world full of distractions. You notice that? And you know, it was like that before social media, but now there's we're endlessly distracted by everything. Have you shut off your dings? And all, I shut my dings off, I think. I just got a new phone, and it's got three different volume things. So I have to shut all of them if I'm going to give a speech. It's really getting quite annoying. But anyway, but it's fun. It goes fast now. Oh, my gosh. But this image here that Bunyan is trying to burn into our mind. Right? By the way, Bunyan spent many long years in jail for being a nonconformist, for being what we would call a Puritan later on. And he wrote some of this in jail, some of it later, kind of back and forth. But he understood the urgency, and this image he gives us also captures that urgency. We need to flee now, not stop and take stock of things, but go. Right? Now, if you've read it, you know that as he travels on, he has this huge burden on his back. It's like literally a giant knapsack. And I've seen versions where they make it gigantic or smaller, but he's bowled down by this knapsack. And of course, that is the burden of his own sinfulness. And it takes, you know, about a 25% into the book is when he finally gets his burden relieved. But his burden is relieved when he comes to the foot of the cross. Let me read that to him and just read a few of these things that, again, to me are particularly vivid, right? There are a lot of parts in this book that, unless you're a theologian, you might start at sleeping, because they get into all sorts of, and basically, you know what it's like? Have any of you had a dialogue with a hardcore Calvinist? That's what it's like, okay? They won't let you get away with anything, man, okay? And again, he is a Calvinist, okay? Although, it's funny, because we need to realize there's danger on the road. I don't know if you got to the end of this book, but when he gets to the celestial city, there turns out to be a pit directly down to hell there. That doesn't sound to me like perseverance of the saints, but anyway, so I don't know. So he's a Calvinist, but there's a little bit of what we call the sort of holiness movement, purity movement, as we think. Because I'm a Baptist, and you know, there are two kinds of Baptists. They're the Anabaptists, who are the holiness movement. They're always, and then there's the Baptists that are very, very much Calvinists, like the Puritans. And he is a Puritan, but I see elements of the other Baptists when I read this too. It's kind of, they're almost mingled together, I think in a positive way. But isn't that scary? Come on, how many of you played with your kids' chutes and ladders? You know that, right? Like, you get up there, and like just before the end, if you get the wrong chute, you're all the way back down. Of course, sometimes you get the ladder that takes you all the way up. But again, so there's always a little bit of, I don't know if we quite have this sort of security that we normally do in Calvinism. But anyway, he comes to there, and it says, he ran thus till he came at a place somewhat ascending, and upon that place stood a cross, and a little below, in the bottom, a sepulcher, right, a tomb. So I saw in my dream that just as Christian came up with the cross, his burden loosed from off his shoulders and fell from off his back and began to tumble, and so continued to do till it came to the mouth of the sepulcher, where it fell in, and I saw it no more. Then was Christian glad and lightsome, and said with a merry heart, he hath given me rest by his sorrow, and life by his death. Then he stood still a while to look and wonder, for it was very surprising to him that the sight of the cross should thus ease him of his burden. He looked therefore and looked again, even till the springs that were in his head sent the waters down his cheeks. Very poetic way of saying, he's crying. Now, as he stood looking and weeping, behold, three shining ones came to him and saluted him with, peace be to thee. So the first said to him, thy sins be forgiven. The second stripped him of his rags and clothed him with change of raiment. The third also set a mark on his forehead and gave him a roll with a seal upon it, which he bid him look on as he ran, and that he should give it in at the celestial gate. Again, that's what it's like. It's not just that we come before the cross and Christ's sacrifice not only removes our burden. What a wonderful image that it rolls down and down and down and disappears into the tomb, right? And it's gone, right? Do you all have a baptistry? You don't have a Baptist, okay, because it just happened this morning. I don't remember, you guys are non-denominational.
No, we're Baptist.
You're Baptist, okay, but you don't have a baptistry. Oh, it's portable, okay. So you do the same thing when you do a baptism, you say buried in baptism, raised to new life, something like that, right? Yeah, because we had a baptism this morning at my church. And again, it strikes you again, that powerful image of buried in baptism. Now see, I'm the strange fellow who grew up Greek Orthodox. And when you're Greek Orthodox, you are infant baptized, but by immersion. And they don't just immerse you once. Orthodox people do everything in threes, everything, okay? And three times you're put under, right? Woo! I don't remember it. I was a baby. Okay, I've got the pictures. I won't show you the pictures because I'm naked. But anyway, down I go three times, okay? Yeah, all those pictures that we took, you know, they took when you're the kids, they would be censored now, you know? All those little nudie pictures, they'd be censored now. But anyway, anyway, that powerful image of literally our sins are buried in the tomb, right? What does Paul say about we will die with him so we also might rise with him? I think it's Philippians. We're buried and but it's powerful. So it's not just the image of that giant burden rolling down like a giant snowball. You've heard of those things, snowballs? Oh yeah, we had the freeze. Now we know what they are, okay. And we're glad, okay. You know, let's not, you know, annoy our politicians because everything was a mess. I mean, really, this happens like once every 500 years, okay. I mean, everybody attacking everybody. It's just like, this is not gonna happen again, okay. I've been here 30 years, only once, and the cold never stays more than a day. I mean, come on, anyway, I don't know. We always have to have somebody to blame, basically. That's what it means to be an American. Somebody always is to blame. But anyway, the rest of the world is not like that, by the way. That's our problem in America. But anyway, so this image is not only of a burden lifted, it is of a burden gone. It rolls into the tomb and disappears, right? And then he gets all those marks, all those things, the new clothing, right, the garments and praise, and he moves forward. And I'll read one more, a little bit longish passage, but this one I think is maybe his best. And this is when he reaches the celestial city, right? But to get to the celestial city, he must pass through the River Jordan. We were just talking before that in the old spirituals, right? You've ever heard the old spirituals? Joshua at the Battle of Jericho. Whenever River Jordan's mentioned, it is a symbol of death, right? Because Joshua, right? And we all know that Joshua means Jesus. Joshua is the way that non-Hispanic people can name their son Jesus, okay? As far as I know, I don't know anybody, white, black, Asian, the only people I've ever seen named Jesus are usually Hispanic, but other people want to name their kids Jesus, so you call them Joshua. That's the way you sneak it in because it's basically the same name, Yeshua. So God saves, right? So Joshua, Yeshua, right? Joshua leads the people of Israel across the River Jordan into the Promised Land in the same way that Jesus leads us across the river of death into paradise, the New Jerusalem, whatever, right? So what is it? If you've ever seen a showboat, show me that stream called the River Jordan. That's the old stream I would love to cross, right? It's getting to your home, but it also means death. And so he comes to the River Jordan, and this is what happens. I'll read this a little bit longer. Now I further saw that betwixt them and the gate of the city, was a river, but there was no bridge to go over, and the river was very deep. At the sight, therefore, of this river, the pilgrims are Christian and his friend Hopeful, two of them, we'll talk about Hopeful later, they're there, were much astounded. But the men that went with them said, you must go through, or you cannot come at the gate. The pilgrims then began to inquire if there was no other way to the gate, to which they answered, yes, but there hath not any save two, to wit, Enoch and Elijah, been permitted to tread that path since the foundation of the world, nor shall until the last trumpet shall sound. The pilgrims then, especially Christian, began to despond in his mind and looked this way and that, but no way could be found by them by which they might escape the river. Then they asked the men if the waters were all of a depth. They said, no, yet they could not help them in that case. For, said they, you shall find it deeper or shallower as you believe in the king of the place. They then addressed themselves to the water, and entering, Christian began to sink, and crying out to his good friend Hopeful, he said, I sink in deep waters. The billows go over my head. All the waves go over me. Then said the other, be of good cheer, my brother. I feel the bottom, and it is good. Then said Christian, ah, my friend, the sorrows of death have compassed me about. I shall not see the land that flows with milk and honey. And with that, a great darkness and horror fell upon Christian, so that he could not see before him. Also here he, in a great measure, lost his senses, so that he could neither remember nor orderly talk of any of those sweet refreshments that he had met with in the way of his pilgrimage. But all the words that he spake still tended to discover that he had horror of mind and heart fears, that he should die in that river and never obtain entrance in at the gate. Here also, as they that stood by perceived, he was much in the troublesome thoughts of the sins that he had committed, both since and before he began to be a pilgrim. 'Twas also observed that he was troubled with apparitions of hobgoblins and evil spirits, for ever and anon he would intimate so much by his words. Hopeful, therefore, here had much ado to keep his brother's head above water. Yea, sometimes he would be quite gone down, and then ere a while he would rise up again, half dead. Hopeful also would endeavor to comfort him, saying, brother, I see the gate, and men standing by to receive us. But Christian would answer, tis you they wait for. You have been Hopeful ever since I knew you. And so have you, said, and so have you, said he to Christian. Ah, brother, said he, surely, if I was right, he would now rise to help me. But for my sins he hath brought me into the snare and hath left me. Then said Hopeful, my brother, you have quite forgot the text where it is said of the wicked. There is no bands in their death, but their strength is firm. They are not troubled as other men, neither are they plagued like other men. These troubles and distresses that you go through in these waters are no sign that God hath forsaken you, but are sent to try you, whether you will call to mind that which heretofore you have received of his goodness and live upon him in your distresses. Then I saw in my dream that Christian was as in a muse a while, to whom also Hopeful added these words, be of good cheer. Jesus Christ maketh thee whole. And with that, Christian break out with a loud voice, oh, I see him again, and he tells me, when thou passest through the waters, I will be with thee, and through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. Then they both took courage, and the enemy after that was as still as a stone, until they were gone over. Christian therefore presently found ground to stand upon, and so it followed that the rest of the river was but shallow. Thus they got over. Wow. If I read the whole thing, I'd explode. That's hard to do. Okay. Can you feel that? I just wanted to give, that's the only long passage I'll give you. But you understand all the different scripture verses coming together, Old and New Testament alike, coming together, and we understand the terror of that, right? Because unless we're, by the way, what's special about Elijah and Enoch? Sunday school quiz. What's special about Elijah and Enoch? Yeah, they were taken straight up. Enoch, it said, Enoch walked with God and he was taken, he was no more. And Elijah, of course, went up in the golden chariot, which is another old spiritual. Swing low, sweet chariot. Right, so those are the two. Some people think those will be the two witnesses in the book of Revelation. I don't know. But they're the two, only two, that, so to speak, went to heaven without dying. Even Jesus had to die, physically die in the body. Right? So they must go through this, and it's wonderful that we're trying to find the ground under us, and depending on our faith, we can feel it or not, and we need Hopeful. And there's the image that the people on the other side of the river are calling to them, don't lose hope, continue forward. But that's what it feels like, doesn't it? He obviously had in mind the River Jordan, but he probably also had in mind Peter. When Peter says to Jesus, call me out on the water, right? And Peter begins to walk, and as long as he keeps his eyes focused on Jesus, everything's fine, right? But he takes his eyes, he hears the billowing of the waves, and what happens? Yeah, he starts to sink slowly, right? Which is really not the way a person sinks, right? Right? But again, it's the powerful thing here we get. Slowly, he sinks into the heaviness. Jesus, save me, and he takes him out of the boat as Hopeful helps him out of the water. Right? But again, this makes all of these things concrete. Right? Tangible. We need to understand this, right? That we must indeed die in the body if we are to be raised to a new life. Wow. All right. As he goes along the road. Now, here's another important thing you may have noticed, that in this book, Christian is not some kind of super saint, right? He's not super smart. He's not super brave. He's not super spiritual. He's a regular person. That's the whole point, right? Regular, everyday person. But he learns to have faith. He learns perseverance, long-suffering. Isn't that a beautiful? Hey, where's your mom? It's not a speech without your mom here. Is she okay? Oh, she's okay. All right, okay. Because she, because like I said, I mean, I know her because when I make a good joke, you know, her laughter just fills the whole room, and it's kind of like saying amen to the preacher, kind of gets you going. Right? But anyway, so yeah, tell her I'm thinking about her. Anyway, I will be back with. I've already set to come back to the Colson Fellows in November, so I'll be doing that. Have you all done that Colson Fellows thing? It's pretty neat. Yeah, but anyway, I'm still doing that. You're the one that brought me the first time, but we're already set. They got the date on the calendar now, so that was smart. Anyway, because I'm expecting a lot of gigs now that life is returning already. I had to cancel two because they overlapped already. But okay, so What does he have? Well, Lot was not a perfect person either. But what did Lot not do that his wife did? He didn't look back, right? Turn back, turn to a pillar of stone, right? A pillar of salt, rather. And so he continued on, right? He looks forward. He continues on. He's a simple man, and he makes a lot of mistakes, as you see, right? But he's always forgiven, and he tries, right? Now, when he first leaves the city of destruction, he convinces a guy named Pliable to come with him, right? But you think about it. Pliable is the kind of person that's going to follow you when things are going well, but not going to follow you when things go poorly, right? Now, you know the famous parable of the sower, right? Interestingly, the seed is always the same. The seed of the gospel does not change. What changes is the ground. And our heart can be the rocky ground, or it can be the shallow soil, or it can be amongst the thorns, or it can be the good soil. And pliant is the kind, right? Now, remember the first one that falls along the path, it falls and immediately the birds eat it up, the devil takes it. But the next one that are on the shallow ground, well, what happens? Because the earth, because the soil is shallow, it springs up quickly. But when the sun comes out, it withers, because what does it not have? It doesn't really have roots, okay? It doesn't have roots. And of course, the sun is a metaphor for persecution. When any kind of persecution or difficulty comes, they go away. And what we get are all the different bad soils, right? That it's swallowed up, it doesn't bear fruit, it's choked out by the thorns. But Pilgrim, Christian, is the good soil. Now, shortly after they leave the city of destruction, they come to, now the proper pronunciation is the Slough of Despond, okay? S-L-O-U-G-H is pronounced slough when we're talking about a snake sloughing off its skin, right? But this kind is pronounced a slough because it's kind of like a swamp, like a little marsh, like our city or the state of Louisiana, okay? I mean, we are living in a slough, right? Which sounds like almost a pretty word, but anyway, the Slough of Despond. And what happens is just as they set out, they fall into the Slough of Despond and they start sinking. And Christian's fighting as hard as he can, but Pliable says, whoa, this is not what I signed on for. Where's all those celestial choirs you promised me and all this beautiful hymn scene? What's going on? I'm out of here. And he scrambles out on the city of destruction side and leaves, and he never sees him again, right? And it's kind of a weird description, but the idea is when we first confess our sins and we first believe, even if it's, you know, loosely like Pliable, you know, there's like a sloughing off of our sinfulness and our grief and all, and it sort of falls into this slough of despond, and it's easy to be snared in there and be unable to move out. This is cool. We got like three cameras going here. This is really cool. I should have brought the thing you gave me, the Oscar, the first time I spoke. I brought that with me. It's still in my house here. But anyway, so again, that first danger, people run off. And maybe it, now, one hopes that there's another story where Pliable changes his mind, right? Can you think of a young man who went on a mission trip and got scared and ran away, but clearly came back to the Lord? You know what his name was? Yeah, Mark, right? John Mark, right? Mark went on the first missionary journey with Paul and Barnabas, right? But he ran, it doesn't tell us why he ran away. Maybe he was afraid of the pirates, whatever, but he ran away. And that's why Paul said, Paul won't give him a second chance. I personally think Barnabas is the one that's writing this, because Mark proved that he came back. He became right-hand man to Peter. He wrote a gospel that we call the Gospel of Mark. And at the end of his life, when Paul was in prison, he said, send Mark to me because he's helpful to me in my ministry. So, you know, the Pliables of the world can come back. Okay, and by the way, if you're not absolutely exhausted, there is a second book called the second part where his wife and children follow, and it's not quite as famous, but it's kind of neat. Like they get their chance too, right? This is not like you messed up one time and you're out. That's modern day cancel culture. One thing, one strike, and you're out. Even if the strike you made was 10 years ago, it's a pilgrim. It's just part two. It's just part two. Yeah, some. It depends what. Not all. Like I said, I would say most editions have it, the first part and the second part, but they don't rely on each other. But it's just kind of neat because the sequel is Christiana is his wife's name. And they go on and they, and basically the biggest difference with the second book is there's a little bit more sense of the church. There's a little more sense of the pilgrims having more support, whereas a Christian, he does have some friends, but he's often a lone guy, like somebody going off on his own. And maybe, you know, Bunyan thought, oh, well, you know. And Bunyan wrote other ones. By the way, if you like this, Bunyan wrote a book called Grace to the Chief of Sinners. No, Grace Abounding to the Chief of Sinners. And that's his spiritual autobiography of his own journey. That's pretty accessible. He wrote a lot of other things too, but that's the most accessible. Again, he was not a highly educated person. He was a tinker. Those are people that go around and fix things. He basically grew up in the King James Bible. That's what it was. And he speaks in a vernacular, sort of mixed together. It's a unique kind of speech. And for about 200 years, this was the number two bestseller after the Bible. I mean, for a long time. Now, it isn't anymore, but for a long time it was. And there's so many editions of this. And there's lots of movies. There's no great movie because it's what we call an episodic book. But recently, there's a cartoon version that's worth watching. It's not great, but it does a few things well. It has the voice of the lovely singer, Kristen Getty. Kristen Getty does the voice, and also one of the voices is Gimli, John Rhys-Davies, who is clearly a believer. I've seen him interviewed. So there's a few good voices. It's a little bit hokey, but some of it works well. But this is not something you make a movie out of. It's in your head, right? So anyway, okay. A little bit later on, he meets the worldly wise man. I mean, and a lot of these phrases have come into our language because of him, right? So worldly wise man, they all have names like that. And he sends him to the city of legality. Watch out for legalism. But there's a great scene, and it's another one of those memorable scenes, where he's going along the street of legality, and all of a sudden, he sees a mountain about to fall on his head. And Bunyan identifies that as Mount Sinai, which is, of course, where Moses got the Ten Commandments, right? So legalism, right, will crush you if you're not careful. Right? He also meets people named Ignorance. He meets Talkative, right? All of these people. But in and out is Evangelist. Now, if you want to have fun and you have Amazon Prime, right, and look, I know I should probably get rid of it because those people are evil and they're taking over the world, but I can't. That's my worldly wise man. I want my 2-day free shipping, which is usually 1-day free shipping. But anyway, if you have Amazon Prime, go on the movie part and type in The Pilgrim's Progress. They've got an old version made in the 70s, made by a church, very, very hokey, but it stars a young Liam Neeson. And Liam Neeson plays he plays Evangelist, he plays Jesus, he plays all the good guy helpers. And he's good. So you might, just for fun. I mean, like I said, parts of it are really hokey. Other parts work. But anyway, if you just type in Pilgrim, it should still be there on Amazon. I'm sure they wouldn't even notice to take it off. But anyway, it's there. Good. Wait, what's that? Oh, I don't. You know, I might have seen that because I remember seeing one where he's got a gigantic burden. And that fight, yeah, I have that. That's pretty good. There's a really good fight scene that the guys like with the sword and stuff like that. So there's all different ones, but it's not. It's like Alice in Wonderland. It's really not something you make a movie out of because it's one little. That's why don't try to make a movie out of Dante's Divine Comedy. You can't make a movie out of that. It's all episodes, one after another. Maybe you can make a TV miniseries, maybe, but not a movie. Anyway, so. But he meets all these people, but Evangelist is always there. Whenever he needs them, he's there. He's helping them back and forth. But let's focus on some of the best-known episodes. Now, along the way, like I said, he does get some helpers along the way. And the two most important are Faithful, who ends up being martyred, and then he's succeeded by Hopeful, whom we just saw makes it to the Celestial City alongside him. Now, again, a lot of phrases have come into our language because of this book and also because of the King James translation. But the one that probably is the best is Vanity Fair. There was even a famous novel called Vanity Fair from the 19th century. And we need to understand that this book is being written in the 17th century. This is really the birth time of what we would call international capitalism, were starting to get trade in the Renaissance, particularly with the city of Florence, which, right, it's a swamp. It's a swamp as well, actually, but it's romantic. It's a romantic swamp, unlike ours. But anyway, why did we not build our own river walk when it was financially possible, right? I don't know if there's enough money in Houston to build a river walk here now, right? I mean, you had to do this like during the Great Depression or something. I don't know, you know. Anyway, but I just forgot what I was saying. Okay, so, but in the 17th century, it really starts, and if there's any inventor of international capitalism, it is the Dutch, okay? The Netherlands, Holland, and stuff like that, Rotterdam, Amsterdam, they are the ones that really started the full international trade and things, right? And that's capitalism. Now, we need to understand that there are two problems with capitalism, okay? And my guess is most of you are pretty conservative here. I believe in the free market. I believe in capitalism, but it can go bad, okay? And there's two bad things about capitalism, though. One is, obviously, when you start to exploit your workers, right? But there's another problem with capitalism that we as Christians need to be mindful of, and that is, in a capitalist system, everything becomes a commodity. Everything is for sale, right? And that's the danger, right? That everything has a price tag. Let me just read one more passage to explain the origin of the fair, because again, I think this is maybe Bunyan at his best. Okay, they come in here and we learn this fair, Vanity Fair, and remember, this is vanity as in the old King James, vanity of vanity, saith the preacher. Vanity means empty, vain, that kind of stuff, right? Meaningless, empty. This fair is no new erected business, but a thing of ancient standing. I will show you the original of it. Almost 5,000 years agone, there were pilgrims walking to the celestial city as these two honest persons are. And Beelzebub, Apollyon, and Legion, all the demons, came after them, with their companions, perceiving by the path that the pilgrims made that their way to the city lay through this town of vanity, they contrived here to set up a fair wherein should be sold all sorts of vanity, and that it should last all the year long. Therefore, at this fair are all such merchandises sold as houses, lands, trades, places, honors, preferments, titles, countries, kingdoms, lusts, pleasures, and delights of all sorts, as whores, bawds, wives, husbands, children, masters, servants, lives, blood, bodies, souls, silver, gold, pearls, precious stones, and whatnot. Very important. What does he say? Hordes, bawds, wives, husbands, children. Everything becomes a commodity. Even actual marriage becomes a commodity. Something that happens over an accounting desk or something like that. We need to be careful, right? That's why one of the terrible things is when the university becomes only a business, or the schools become nothing more than a business, or churches become a business, right? Have you ever had where they want to come in and do, what would you call that? Like companies will do a new, I'm trying to think what word to use, a new initiative for excellence, that kind of stuff. You know, companies are always doing that, and they've been doing it for a while. But then, I don't remember when it started, churches started doing that. Is that really the way we should think, right? And please remember that the sign you have a good church is not a sign that it grows by 100 people every year. I mean, if that is what God wants to do, if that's your charisma, but it's difficult to be a preacher because you naturally feel like you must be doing something wrong if your church is not growing and growing and growing into a mega church, right? No, look, if that's the criterion, Jesus was really bad. He was able to get 12 disciples and they all ran away. And I mean, so we have to, this idea of quantity rather than quality, but it's in all of us, right? It's in teachers, it's in preachers. We're taught that everything is about numbers, right? One of the things that drives me crazy, because my big thing is bringing Athens and Jerusalem together. You've heard me talk about that before. And anybody that wants to do that, we immediately go to Acts 17, Paul speaking at the Areopagus at Mars Hill. And I've heard a lot of people, it's true, only a few people were saved. And so a lot of modern people say, oh, that was obviously an unsuccessful sermon. Really? Okay, come on, right? So we need, but everything is a commodity. Everything needs to be calculated now, on a list. Everything is about, oh, my least favorite word, accreditation. Oh my gosh, closing the loop, all of these things. Okay, now, obviously we want to be our best and strive for Christ. But again, this idea that we need to put a numerical value on everything is very dangerous. It's not good for the soul, right? We start putting a price tag on each one of our children, right? Or even putting a price tag on an education, right? Now, it's so expensive now. We want to do that, but we need to think. So again, Vanity Fair is, it's about, you know, consumerism more than capitalism, okay? Capitalism has its good and its bad. I mean, you all know, if you're really honest, that nothing has helped relieve poverty. The gospel, number one, capitalism, number two, okay? Now, so what I'm saying, capitalism is not all evil, okay? But we need to be careful we don't fall into, again, using and misusing people. But I want to focus. Most of us are probably not in a position where we can abuse our workers, okay? I don't know if there's anybody that like owns a factory here, okay? But all of us can easily fall prey to consumerism, to the idea of putting a price tag. Now, look what he says on the next page. After talking about what Vanity Fair is, look what we discover. Now, as I said, the way to the celestial city lies just through this town. I mean, at the end, you've got to go through the River Jordan, as we said. But you have to go through the fair. Every one of us is going to have to face the fair at some point in our life. And look what he explains. He says, the celestial city lies just through this town where this lusty fair is kept. And he that will go to the city, the celestial city, and yet not go through this town, must needs go out of the world. Because this is the fair of the world. The prince of princes himself, that would be Jesus, the prince of princes himself, when here, in other words, when he was on the earth, went through this town to his own country, and that upon a fair day too. Yea, and as I think, it was Beelzebub, the chief lord of this fair, that invited him, Jesus, to buy of his vanities. Yea, would have made him lord of the fair, would he but have done him reverence as he went through the town. Yea, because he was such a person of honor, Beelzebub had him from street to street and showed him all the kingdoms of the world in a little time, that he might, if possible, allure that blessed one to cheapen and buy some of his vanities. But he had no mind to the merchandise, and therefore left the town without laying out so much as one farthing upon these vanities. This fair, therefore, is an ancient thing of long standing and a very great fair. Now, do you know specifically what Bible story he's referring to? Yeah, it's the temptation, right? There's three temptations. One of them, I will offer you all the kingdoms of the world if you will bow down and worship me. And he said, you know, get thee gone, Satan, right? Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God and the Lord only, right? But we never thought about it that way. But trying to make Jesus lust after the kingdoms of the world. So we all have to face Vanity Fair in our own way. And we don't necessarily have to be a rich person, okay? Because we're taught we have to have this, we have to have these, we have to have these things. That make a difference. Or if we may not have any money, but we still have to have an expensive cell phone. Folks, look, you don't have to spend $1,000, okay? This was $150. I probably could have got $100. And it does everything. It just doesn't have that little thing that says iPhone on it, okay? Again, beware. I'm amazed at people my age who, like, I need a new this every year or every 6 months or I can't survive. Really, folks? Okay, we can survive, okay? It's so hard to get that out of our mind. Everything is to be bought and sold. And aren't we told that our duty as citizens is to spend as much money on Black Friday as we can, right? right? And of course, you know, does anybody know why it's actually called Black Friday? It gets you in the black, okay? If you have a business in the red, means you're dead. In the black means you're fine. And apparently, a lot of stores make almost all their budget on Black Friday. It's amazing. What's that? Oh, you go into the red. Very good. That's right. We go in the red. They go in the black, right? So, unbelievable. So, anyway. But the now, what happens? When they're in the fair, Christian and hopeful are resisting. They're not going to, I don't want your wares, sir, right? And his friend Faithful ends up dying a martyr's death. He's put on trial. I'm not going to read it to you, but the 12 jurors all have wonderful names, wonderful allegorical names. It's very crazy. But I want you to understand, why do the fairgoers hate Faithful particularly, okay? This may be the first example in literature of cancel culture, okay? They are canceling him. And they're very happy. As long as you buy our wares and accept that life is all commodities, we'll let you go. Or at least stop talking. But we are going to cancel you, okay? We just killed your Facebook account, okay? And they put it, you need to understand, what I'm trying to get at is that sometimes we think if we just mind our own business, the world will not be mad at us. Well, that was never true, but it's particularly not true today, right? We're expected to give lip service to whatever the fashionable thing. I'm not going to go into it. You know what's going on. If we don't give lip service, we are sometimes, they get angry because our very presence exposes the lies of their consumer goods. I think one of the most important passages in the Gospels that's easy to miss is John chapter 7, if you want to look it up later. It's the one of the festivals is about to happen. I think it's booths or something. But one of the festivals is about to happen in Jerusalem, right? And all good Jews were supposed to go three times a year. And Jesus' brothers, right, said to him, "Hey, Jesus, why don't you go to the fair and, you know, basically, you know, work on your product. Well, what's the word I want? Your product line or whatever. You know, get what's the word we use now? Your brand. Jesus, this is the time to go and market your brand." Right? And it's really interesting because they say that, and then John says, because his own brothers didn't believe in him. You see, at first, we might think that was good advice. They're trying to help their brother. Go out, do it. This is the time for marketing. Jesus doesn't go. But what does Jesus say? No, you can go anytime you want, but I can't go now. Then he says, because the world hates me, because I testify against it, that its ways are sinful or evil. Now, this is important. We don't see Jesus actually saying anything. It's his mere presence that convicts, right? Have you ever had a non-believing friend or family member that just starts digging into you and you haven't actually said anything? I know you're judging me. I know you're judging me. Now, sometimes we are, but what I'm saying, even when we're not, even when we're being good Christians, our mere presence is sometimes an affront to someone who doesn't want God peeping into their life. Okay, so if you kind of keep it in mind that scene, because in a sense, Faithful has not done anything wrong. Faithful has not stolen anything. He's not tried to burn down the fair, right? I mean, he hasn't done anything specifically, but his very presence is a threat to the fair. And so they end up putting him to death, right? They cancel him quite literally. Right? Now, he survives. Christian survives. And by the way, you remember what the word martyr means in Greek? You taught them this? It means witness. Martyros means witness. So the martyr is the one who bears the ultimate witness with their life, right? So Christian, not everybody's martyred. Christian goes on, and later on he meets Hopeful, who is Hopeful, like his name says. And as they go along, Christian's getting a little bit tired, and he wants to take the easy path, bypass meadow. I know a shortcut. Hopeful doesn't want to go, but Christian talks him into the shortcut. And what happens is they get stuck, they fall asleep, and they're basically captured and kidnapped by Giant Despair. Despair with a capital D. And Giant Despair throws them in the castle, and there they're rotting away in the castle of despair. Right? And every day, the giant comes and beats them. But he doesn't kill them. He can't kill them. What he's trying to do is to get them to despair so much that they will kill themselves. So that's the horror. And again, everybody, I mean, not everybody feels what we call clinical despair, but we've all felt at least a little bit of despair in our times. And is that not what despair is like? A giant that is crushing you? You feel locked up in a dark dungeon, and there you rot, and every day the giant comes to, you know, molest you, sort of. It's that feeling of being pressed down. And Hopeful says, no, don't give in. Play the man. Remember when you played the man in Vanity Fair. Don't give up. And, you know, I don't know if anybody's ever kept a prayer journal. One of the most important reasons for that is if you have a journal where you have your prayers and you have when God answered that prayer, the reason why you want that book is so when you go through a time of depression, when you feel abandoned by God and that your prayers are not answered and that the doors of heaven are slammed in your face, open up and read it and be reminded of all the times God sustained you. And that's what Hopeful is basically trying to tell him. Well, they sit there rotting until what did they discover? All along, they've got it here, the key of promise. They put that key, and he very specifically says, one gate after another opened. Because remember when Peter escapes from prison, and the angel hits him, and the chains fall off, and they go on. If you ever get to go to the Vatican, they've got a great painting of that by, I think it's by Raphael, great painting of him coming out of prison, and the light, and the angel there, and stuff like that. But all along, we're here. We have the promise. Despair has no control over us, right? And we learn that even more because at one point he faces Apollyon. It's like Apollyon, it looks like. It's usually pronounced Apollyon. And that's a Greek word that means destroyer. It seems to be the equivalent of the Hebrew word abaddon, right? And it's another name of Satan. And they get into a fight. And what does Apollyon do to break down Christian? He reminds him of all his sins. Remember when you did this? Remember the slough of despond? Remember this? Remember when you were nervous? Remember when we wanted to turn back? You never can be forgiven. Whispering in his ear, right? Remember, I think I talked about this in another speech. Satan means accuser in Hebrew. Accusing him, accusing him, accusing him. And finally, he fights back. But what is his sword? The sword of the Spirit. In some ways, one of the greatest allegories is when Paul tells us to put on the full armor of God, right? The helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, the feet shod with the gospel of peace, the shield of faith with which to extinguish the fiery darts of the enemy, right? And the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And a lot of preachers remind you that's the only offensive weapon. Although I've had a few clever preachers remind me that in real ancient fighting, people use their shield as a weapon too, but whatever, okay? But the offensive weapon is the word of God. And do you know somebody else who used the word of God to resist temptation? Yeah, all three times Jesus answers with scripture. By the way, did any of you ever look up where those scripture verses come from? All three of them come from Deuteronomy chapter 6, 7, and 8. You know what that means to me? I can't prove it. It means to me that maybe during his 40 days in the wilderness, Jesus' quiet time was Deuteronomy. Okay? Isn't that interesting? Right? Because he could have used other parts of the Bible. Maybe that's what he was meditating on. He probably had it memorized anyway. Maybe that's what he was going through. Because, you know, Deuteronomy sort of sums up the whole five books. Second law giving it means in Greek. But isn't that cool? That's my interpretation. I can't prove it. Anyway, so again, and I kind of said this before, but I want to emphasize it here. Notice that Bunyan quotes the Old Testament just as much as the New Testament. We need to understand that. I mean, that sort of proves Christianity is true, okay? I mean, it is the Hebrew Bible. But for Christians, we not only completely believe that that's the Word of God, we are completely invested in it as we are in the New Testament, right? It's all there. Okay, and what two people love the Old Testament in American history are the Puritans and the Black Christians, right? Because both of them were coming out of some kind of persecution, either slavery or the Church of England persecuting them. And they both identified very much with the children of Israel coming out of Egypt. Hence, spiritual songs talking about the River Jordan, right? But it's important. We need to understand. We need to read the Old Testament, right? It's full of promises and tells us about God's will. And you know, okay, maybe you can skip over the genealogies, okay? But hey, have you ever met some Christians from Africa who say the genealogy is their favorite part, right? If you come from a tribal group where genealogies are important, right? There are some missionaries who talk about, these people are actually interested in Leviticus, right? The part we skip over. Okay, so you know, the whole counsel of God is there, okay? And we need other people to help us to understand it. So anyway, okay. Now, we go along the road, and it's full of dangers. Okay, we need to understand that. And many times, Christian is going along a path where there are, what would you call them, like gullies or trenches on either side. What would we call them? You know, holes, whatever. So what? Trench, ditches. That's the word I want. Thank you. Easy word, but that's the word. Thank you. Ditches on both sides, right? There are certain places in Houston where you drive and there's ditches on both sides. Yeah, I think there's a couple here, right? And you've heard the phrase Scylla and Charybdis. That's the Odyssey. But what's interesting in what are the two main ditches we have to avoid? We've already mentioned one, and that's legalism, right? Thinking that we can earn God's salvation. But the other side is a word you don't hear as much. It's antinomianism. Now, how's that for a big word, okay? Nomos is the Greek word that means law. As in, if I'm autonomous, it means I'm a law unto my auto, a law unto myself. And anti, of course, means against. So an antinomian is against the law. That's the kind of people that Paul is arguing against in Romans, I think it's 7, the people who say, hey, if it's all about God's grace, let me sin more so that God's grace will abound. Apparently, that crazy guy, the mad monk Rasputin, seems to have been an antinomian, helped bring down the czar and things like that. Again, let me sin more that grace will abound. So both, we have to be careful, right? We need holy living, but we have to be careful that holy living doesn't become legalism, right? We have to live in grace, but we have to be careful that grace does not become a cover for wickedness, right? So important. But here's the other part that's wonderful, and we need to hear this. And as Americans, you know, this is funny because sometimes people talk about, you know, like comparing us to Europeans and whatnot. Oh, we're lazy, okay? Well, in some ways we're lazy. But more often, our problem as Americans is we work too hard. I don't know about the generation coming up, but most Americans, you know, apparently a lot of Americans don't even use their vacation time. It piles up. Now, part of that is because Americans, you know, all of this, you know, talking back and forth, you know, what is white, okay? I'm sorry, but working hard and being on time is not white, okay? That's just being, okay, but there is one true thing that people don't talk about because they don't really understand what they're talking about. There is one thing that I would say is a white, and when I say white, I mean really white, okay? I'm white, but I'm not really white. I'm Greek, okay? I'm Mediterranean. My relatives are much more like Mexicans than we are like Germans. Okay, when I say white, I mean Anglo. Germans, British, Swiss, those kind of things, right? And it is true that in those countries, there is something called the Protestant work ethic, okay? And there's a difference between working hard and being on time, okay? The Protestant work ethic, and some of you may have grown up with this, is this idea that you not only work hard, but that all of your goodness and morality rests upon always working, right? So when I'm on vacation, I even have to be working somehow, right? I have to be listening to sermons while I'm on vacation or something, right? That is a problem. That can befall anybody. But if you want to talk about white as in terms of Anglo, that is a problem. And it does go back to what they call, some of you may have read a book in school by Max Weber. It's called The Weber Thesis, The Spirit of Capitalism Coming Out of the Protestant Work Ethic. This idea that we start to believe that we can only know we're a member of the elect if God blesses us financially. It's different than success in life gospel. It's not success in life gospel. It's more subtle than that. It's the idea that I only know I'm in God's will if I'm always working hard and I'm making money, but I never actually stop to enjoy the money because I'm always working.
I don't know if you know what I'm talking about here, okay? But this is something that, you know, that's stronger in England. And that's why it's important, okay, that we need to rest. We need the Sabbath rest. Of course, there are people that then turn the Sabbath into legalism, okay? But I don't know if you notice this, but if you read it, notice that in between all the dangers, there are wonderful places of rest. The palace beautiful, the delectable mountains, the river of God. There is a time for rest and refreshment and relaxation. We need that, right? That's the idea of a sabbatical year, to get away from all of that, right? But again, this is an American thing. You know, the Europeans, look, don't you people ever, you know, you're like the Germans, I think they take off the entire month of August. You know, just this sort of stuff, right? And again, I think it's good that we're an industrious people. But there is a time, you know, the Ecclesiastes, there's a time for rest. And that's one of the beautiful things. And any real good book about living on the road, there's always going to be play. Even in The Wizard of Oz, right? They go to the Emerald City, and they all get scrubbed clean and stuff like that. You remember that, don't you? Anyway. Or what about the Lord of the Rings? Full of danger, but where do they stop? At Rivendell. They stop at Lothlorien, right? There are all these places of rest and refuge along the way. And that's really important. And let me show you, I put a quote for you. That's one of my favorite quotes. It's on the back part of your handout. See how I'm always saving stuff? I told him, print it on the back in front of one sheet of paper. See, we're good stewards. But this is one of my favorite quotes from C.S. Lewis, and it's from a book he wrote called The Problem of Pain. It's his first apologetics book, really. And he says here, it's the second paragraph in the top, This is the nature of the world in which we live, Lewis says. The settled happiness and security which we all desire, God withholds from us by the very nature of the world. But joy, pleasure, and merriment, he has scattered broadcast. We are never safe, but we have plenty of fun and some ecstasy. It is not hard to see why. The security we crave would teach us to rest our hearts in this world and oppose an obstacle to our return to God. A few moments of happy love, a landscape, a symphony, a merry meeting with our friends, a bath, or a football match have no such tendency. Our Father refreshes us on the journey with some pleasant inns, but will not encourage us to mistake them for home. You ever realize that? Okay, that it's like, how many of you have done this? This seems to be even more a male thing. We seem to get mad and then the wife calms you down. It's like you're having the perfect day. Everything goes well, and then you come home and you stub your toe and you start yelling. And your wife's like, relax, stop, don't relax. Ah. It's like, you know what I'm talking about? It's like God, there's always something bad that seems to happen. God just never will give us an absolutely perfect day. But Lewis suggests, then we might rest here, right? We'll forget, this world is not my home, I'm just passing through, getting a little banjo out there. But he gives us all sorts of wonderful moments along the way. All sorts of, we used to call them, what do we call them? Kodak memories, what are the old Kodak commercials? Making memories, you know what I'm talking about? Those old, you know, little snapshots of memories and things like that. By the way, you do know that when the cloud crashes, we're going to lose an entire generation of memories. It's all gone. Nobody prints out, as far as I can tell, nobody prints out pictures anymore. They just look on their phone, and then it will all die, and we'll be gone. And we won't believe anything that happened. But then again, you won't be able to embarrass your children when they're getting ready to be married, because I've got the home videos to show them. Like, someday I'll show my future daughter-in-law. I used to have the one that you put an entire VHS. It was really big in there. And I remember tape recording Alex when he was, 6 months, and getting a bath. You know how you give babies bath in the sink when they're that little? And I could see that the end of the tape was coming. And so I zoomed in on his little baby butt and I said, this is the end of the video. This is the end. And then it dies. That was great. So that will be shown to a future daughter-in-law, you know, if I can find it or I can play it on anything, right? But anyway, but again, I just, it's helpful to remember we're pilgrims on the road. I don't think we have to be like, I mean, you probably know this in the old days, Methodist ministers were always itinerant, right? Am I not understanding that right? That was part of being a Methodist minister. You always were on the move. Whether that's good or bad, I don't know. I mean, certainly the early apostles were on the move. I don't know. I do notice, though, like at HBU, the people that change the most are the people in the, you know, the Christian services or something like that. I don't know if they feel God has moved them on or they're bored. I've never figured out whether they're really listening to God or they're just bored. I'm not really sure, okay? I've been at the same job for 30 years, so I'm one of the old-timers. But what I'm getting at is that we do need to realize that this, now, again, this world is getting us ready because the new heaven and new earth will be this world but perfected. Right? And maybe Bunyan is not quite understanding that a little bit. But still, this compared to heaven, we're living in the shadowlands, as C.S. Lewis would say. And we need to move along the road. And again, this is the kind of book, don't try to sit down and read it beginning to end, or you might hang yourself, okay? This is the kind of book to read devotionally. But if you read it devotionally, make sure you have a bookmark. Because once you close the book, you'll never find your spot again, okay? It really makes you be thankful for things like chapters and sub-chapters, okay? You know, that came a little bit later, right? People had to sort of invent those things, as crazy as that sounds. They had to invent chapter headings and things. But now, how are we doing on time? You want to talk a little bit more? How you doing? You want to have questions? I've got other things I can talk about. But do we have any questions or thoughts? Why don't we do some questions? I put some other things there, but a little dialogue. And I don't think we... Do we have questions from live stream? Are people allowed to send questions in? No, it's not that kind of thing. Okay. Any questions or thoughts? Okay. Now, Bunyan was what they called a nonconformist, right? Because at this point, you know, why do we do this? You know, why do we do it? We break away and start our own denomination. And then when someone breaks away from us, we call them a heretic, right? And this is not just like Baptists that do this, right? Charismatics do it too, right? I mean, I don't know about you, but I normally think of someone who's charismatic as being a more open person and less legalistic and less judgmental. You know, they put on their, but, you know, first you got one wave, then you have another wave, right? And then when the third wave came along, what did they call that? The Vineyard Church? You ever heard of the Vineyard Church, John Wimber? They were probably criticized more by the Assembly of God people than by the Baptists, okay? So what is this about us? It's like we're saying to God, we will go this far and no further, right? Just like worshiping and all that sort of stuff. So at this point, England had the Church of England, Anglican, what we call Episcopal here, the Church of England, and of course the Catholics were in big trouble. They had to, you know, go in hiding. But you needed to be part of the actual church. And if you were a nonconformist, one of the, we would call them low Protestants, I guess, today, then you were in trouble. And Bunyan not only, you know, would not go to the state church, he kept preaching, you know, sort of like in Acts or something like that. He kept preaching the gospel, being in a sense, he was sort of like a preacher that didn't have, what's the word, a stamp of approval, didn't have a, what's the word for that? What's that? Like thinking, that's really what I want. In a sense, he was like an unlicensed preacher. But they wouldn't give him a license for what he was doing. So what are you going to do? It's kind of like he would have said the same thing that that the disciples said. This is actually Peter because Paul's not converted yet. We must obey God rather than you. Remember when the Sanhedrin's telling him not to preach? So he was in prison for that, and then he got out, and right away he went back and started preaching. Like Socrates, let me out, and I'll start teaching again. You're going to have to kill me. And they did. They didn't kill Bunyan, luckily, right? But that was it. It was for being a nonconformist. Now, let's also say, just to be fair to like the Anglicans, did we not all grow up being taught that story that the Puritans were in England and they were being persecuted by the Church of England, so they got in their boats and went to America so they could preach, so they could, you know, live freely their religion? Does anybody know that that's not actually what happened? Okay. Yeah, they went to Holland, and in some ways, Holland was too tolerant. They were too liberal for them, and they were so they got up and left again. So it's kind of funny. We were never told. Maybe today we're told that story. But when I was a kid, I didn't hear that story until 10 years ago or something like that. It's like, oh, that's a little bit of a different story. So we do it, and you know, it happened in the New World sometimes as well. But that was the idea, that he was an unlicensed preacher, and they were trying to keep that down. Right? And like a lot of times, Catholics were arrested because they were recusants, which meant they weren't going to the official church. Right? And some of you, if you've ever been to England, do you see what those old churches look like? Where it's not like this. I'm preaching here, and there are rows, you know, like a football stadium here and over there. Have you ever seen those things? If you go to old Puritan New England, you'll see those old churches. Talk about going to church to be seen rather than to see. You're actually looking at each other. And this is really true. One guy's job was the poker, this long stick. And if you fell asleep, poke you in the ribs with it, okay? Have you ever seen it? Oh, you have one? Ah! That's good. We need that again. Poke him in there, right? So the, pretty funny. It was funny because, you know, during the COVID, we had to tape record our classes for the people that were fully remote. And we had this wonderful gadget that by going on, it told me if the student watched the video and if they watched half of it or all of it, right? But of course, the student still could push play and go outside and, you know, take a walk, right? But I thought, you know, a student can do that in your classroom too, okay? They can also veg out in your classroom and be gone. But the but he was very brave though. So he was, you know, but that's what he was in prison for not conforming and for teaching. It wasn't exactly they were against their doctrine, but they were really low church. The Puritans, okay, forget about no stained glass. They didn't even want a cross, right? I mean, sometimes. They wanted no imagery whatsoever. And some of them did. They called it iconoclast. They went in and tore it down. They might even tear down the altar. I mean, what is, if you're a low Baptist, what is your altar? It's called that thing, the thing that you give your sermon from, okay, right? And so, again, they were still fighting over those things. In England and whatnot. And one of my friends who's really, really into this told me something I didn't realize, that this is going to sound odd to you, but the Labour Party in England earlier in the 20th century were all fans of the Pilgrim's Progress. I mean, there used to be something that you would call Christian socialism. Now, I think it was a disaster, okay? But they really were trying to be for the working class person, right? And of course, I don't want to get into politics, but what's really disturbing about the progressives today is they don't really care about the working man at all. It's really weird. Like, they don't care about people like blue-collar workers. They care about other fashionable things. So, in a sense, one of the reasons why the older Christian Socialist Party wasn't quite as bad, maybe in England, is because they were grounded. I mean, a kind of a social gospel, but not one that went crazy like happens today. It was one that was grounded in the idea of, well, what do they call it? The priesthood of all believers, okay? Baptists, are you familiar with the Baptist phrase, soul competency? Gets us in a lot of trouble sometimes, okay? But soul competency. And actually, I told my preacher once, because he said, why don't you bring your Bible to church like everybody else? And I told him, I said, for two reasons. Okay, the first reason is, if I got my Bible in front of me, I'm not going to be listening to you. I'm going to be flipping through. I mean, I'm easily distracted. Number two, I want to listen to your sermon so I can actually share it with someone else. But the more important part is, and maybe it's because I grew up Greek Orthodox, I told him, I'm not here to check on you every 5 seconds. Okay? I wouldn't be sitting under your teaching if I didn't believe you were a man. Now, if you say something crazy, I'll go home and look it up. I'm discerning, right? But I'm actually here to learn, not to check up on you all the time, okay? And that's what I mean. That's the danger of a sort of soul company that it's just me and God. Ultimately is what it means. I don't need, and you know, and all Baptist churches are really congregational. And we have this thing called this. Did you go to the SBC? Did anybody here go? Okay, well, I wanted to get some stories. But anyway, but they don't really have any power ultimately over the individual congregations, right? But again, this is at a time of ferment in England, right? There's still a lot of fighting. Well, they've sort of, the Catholic versus Protestant thing is slowing down slightly, but then there's all these internal fights over here, back and forth, high and low, right? And some of you know, you can go to a high Anglican church, it almost feels like a Catholic church. Very, very sacramental. Bells and smells, are you familiar with that phrase? Bells and smells. Oh, and you can go to other ones that are very, very low. Lewis himself tended to be fairly sacramental, but as soon as it was over, he ran off. Okay, so he's kind of in between. He sort of did it because he thought he had to. Other thoughts, questions?
Okay.
Well, actually, you chose them. Yeah. I thought, let's try it. Okay, it's kind of fun. Yeah, and the next two will be C.S. Lewis. Be fun. He wanted something challenging. And also, the next two things we're doing, Screwtape Letters, right, and then Great Divorce. Am I getting that right? Yeah, Screwtape Letters and then Great Divorce. I'll send you an outline so you can send it out. They're actually works of fiction. I mean, they're not fiction like the way we think of The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, but they're still using creativity to draw us closer to God and open up dimensions. And that's what we need to do, right? Because a lot, and like you can read that later yourself, but I argue that there are two different people that are suspicious of poetry. And one side are the real fundamentalist Christians, but on the other side are like the super Darwinian left brain people, right? Both of them are like, whoa, this poetry, this literature, this fiction is too slippery, right? I want a one-to-one. We can even do that as Christians. Now, of course I believe in the correspondence theory of truth, that this means this. But sometimes, and particularly Baptists, we take it so far that we want everything to behave, right? One-to-one correspondence. We don't like ambiguity. We'll take poetry if it's in a hymn, because the hymns are also preaching doctrine. So we don't mind. But I think this is kind of the reason you were thinking about it, to get us more open to reading fiction, because this is a way that God reaches us, right? And a lot of times, like I said, you know that particularly Baptists, they were often against any kind of images. Now, I understand that, because there's this thing called thou shalt not make any graven images, okay? But the point was that everything changed with Jesus, right? When the Son of God, takes on mortal flesh, like suddenly the world can bear divinity in a very real way. So it kind of changes things. But again, Bunyan was somebody that was an iconoclast. No, and also, what makes this absolutely unique, other Christian writers, whether it's Augustine or Dante or Chaucer or Milton or John Donne, their literature is full of the Bible, but it's also full of Greco-Roman things. This is so unique. The only thing other than this is George Herbert, another famous poet. This is like only biblical. It's amazing. But still, even though he's trying to be only biblical, he fills it with metaphors and similes and allegories and all these things, right? It's slippery language. But sometimes the only way we can get to the truth is through that sort of slippery language. And so we've got to be careful. In a weird way, sometimes the fundamentalist and the Darwinian are like two peas in a pod, because both of them say, the Darwinian says, the Bible's not a science book, and therefore it's unreliable. And then the fundamentalist says, it is a scientific textbook, and therefore it's reliable. It's neither one, okay? It certainly teaches us true things about science, okay? But you can't, it's not even a textbook. Right? If God wanted to write a textbook, there would be one gospel, not four. Right? How slippery is that? Four gospels? Okay? There'd be one. And we certainly wouldn't have 1st and 2nd Chronicles. What's that all about? Do we really need a rehash of 1st and 2nd Samuel and 1st and 2nd Kings? Why do we need Deuteronomy? That's right. Why do we, we certainly don't need 150 Psalms. I mean, I got it after about 30. Okay? So part of the idea here is to encourage us that it's good. Maybe I'll end by looking at the very bottom, because I thought, to be fair, I'm going to quote one of Bunyan's poems. But I want to warn you now, he is a terrible poet. Oh my God. His poetry in the book goes back and forth between just tolerable and awful. Okay? But anyway, look at the very bottom of page 2. I quoted something that Bunyan includes in the beginning of the book. It's literally his apology for his book. Because he realized, I got to apologize for using all these metaphors and similes, So this is what he says. It's that very bottom paragraph. Okay. Bunyan the Puritan used imaginative literature as a vehicle for divine truth and moral improvement. He defends his ability to do so in an introduction he wrote in poetry. And again, this is towards the beginning. It's actually in the beginning of the book, the preface. And by the way, if you get a chance to watch that new animated version, it's one of those things, it's on Revelation Media, and every so often they'll let you watch it for free on Facebook. If you watch it, make sure there's a little beginning where there's an introduction by the lovely Kristen Getty, you know, in Christ alone. And she speaks in that beautiful Irish accent of hers. And she, in about 5 minutes, gives one of the best defenses I've heard of literature and imagination. Just watch that. Even if you want to watch the movie, watch that little beginning. And then she, like I said, she's one of the voices in the movie as well. Anyway, here's what he says in the poem. Let's just end by going through this. My dark and cloudy words, they do but hold the truth as cabinets enclose the gold. So my words are dark and cloudy because they're vague. They're ambiguous. They're purposely ambiguous. They're not easy to understand. You have to break the code, as we would say. But he says, hey, it is my allegory, my fiction is like a cabinet that's holding precious gold inside of it. That's one of the metaphors he's giving us to defend his own use of metaphor, is that it's keeping it safe within. And the cabinet, we can open the cabinet or peer through the cabinet to see the truth inside. The prophets used much by metaphors to set forth truth. The prophets often use allegory, metaphor, symbol. That's why they're hard to understand. Sometimes the prophets do really weird things. God wants to prepare the Israelites for, you know, the coming, captivity and stuff. And remember what he makes Ezekiel do? You remember that? He makes Ezekiel lay on his side because the city is going to be seized and destroyed. And he makes him lie on his side for like a month or something. It's the weirdest thing in the world, right? The worst of all is he gets Hosea to marry a prostitute who then turns around and leaves him. Gomer, not Gomer Pyle, okay? Who then leaves him, okay? So, you know, were they even thinking about that when they named him Gomer Pyle? Why do you name somebody Gomer? Have you read the Bible? It's kind of weird. I don't know. Why do you name somebody Ichabod? Was it no? I think it means no grace or something, right? Very strange. Okay, anyway. So the prophets use much by metaphor to set forth truth. And of course, one of the vehicles by which God sends us the truth is through visions. And even when it's not an actual dream vision like Nebuchadnezzar, it is prophetic language that reads like dream language. Then he goes on, not just the Old Testament, but, yea, whoso considers Christ, his apostles too, shall plainly see that truths to this day in such mantles be. Mantle is like a cloak or a coat that you wear, right? So, did Jesus use fiction? The parables, right? He spoke in parables. Those are fictional stories. And we know that, but which is the only one story we want to make true? You know which one? Oh, that's kind of, well, no, but the parables, the stories that he does. Which is the one we want to treat as true is the rich man and Lazarus, right? Because we want some information, right? And I understand because it's the only one of all the parables that gives someone a name, Lazarus. And rich man is not a name, but it's Dives in Latin, so that's what they call him, Dives, rich man. But Lazarus is given a name. But anyway, so Jesus does, okay? Paul uses all sorts of metaphors, right, to do it. Like what we call doxologies. So he's just reminding us that Scripture itself not only has a lot of poetry, it conveys truth through. If you want a fancy word, figurative language is kind of the word that we use in English to mean everything. Figurative language includes similes, metaphors, symbols, allegories, all of that sort of stuff. That's figurative. We're speaking figuratively one thing as if it's something else. But the Bible does it all the time, right? And Jesus himself does it. The apostles do it. What about, did you ever try to figure out that weird thing when Paul is trying to explain to us about the two covenants and the two women and the two mountains? Remember that? It was Galatians, I think. What the heck is he talking about? You almost need to be an English major to understand that. Hey, very good. He goes on to say, he says, come truth, although in swaddling clothes. So now the truth is like the baby Jesus. The swaddling clothes now is the figurative language. And look, he gives a list now of what that figurative language helps to do. So come truth, although in swaddling clothes, I find informs the judgment. It kind of goes directly to us. That's why I spent a little while reading those three passages that make concrete the running away, the burden falling off, and the crossing of the River Jordan. It's all there. So informs the judgment, rectifies the mind. That's a word that means make straight the mind. This is kind of a grotesque analogy, but you know what the rectum is? Like in your, okay, because the intestines are all curly-cue all over the place. Apparently, there's like miles of intestines in our bodies. Man, right? But then the rectum is the straight part on your way out. Rectifies the mind, pleases the understanding, right? So there's a pleasure there. It helps us to get a hold or a grasp, makes the will submit. Now, who taught a certain king the need for repentance and obedience by telling him a story? Yeah, very good. Nathan told David the story of the man with the little ewe lamb. And notice how David was convicted to the quick, cut to the quick by that use. Right? Good stuff. And something like that happens again in about, you know, the son, he won't forgive his son. It's a couple times where different people use that method of convicting people. Makes the will submit, the memory too it doth fill with what doth our imagination please. Right? We remember things better than reading sort of pure theology. Give me an image, draw me a picture, and I will remember it. The simplest example of that is, do you do do you do your sermons with a little like acrostic where it spells a word? Oh, you don't do that, but a lot of preachers do that, right? Where it either starts with the same three letters, anagram, something they call it. It either starts with the same three letters or maybe together, like prayer is acts, right? Because A stands for adoration, confession, thanksgiving, and sanctification, right? So a lot of preachers do that. That's another way of engaging. It's a mnemonic device that engages our memory. But a lot of times, do you know what? I was very proud of my son. I heard him give a lecture by Zoom on the Chronicles of Narnia and transformational moments with Aslan. And he talked about this wonderful thing where Aslan teaches this girl four signs that she will need to keep on track. It's from the Silver Chair. But Aslan warns her, when you sink down into Narnia, the air will thicken. Beware it does not confuse your mind. And what is clear up here will not look at all the same down there. And he came up with a great, son of an English major, he said, has this ever happened to you? You're using your GPS and it looks clear on the map, but when you get there, the turn doesn't look anything like it did on your GPS. Usually what happens is they don't realize there's construction and now your turn is about 500 yards closer than it. But anyway, it's like, so wait, but that's what it looked like in the map. No, it's not always clear down here. What's clear up there becomes a little unclear in the world, becomes muddied, and that's part of what Pilgrim's Progress is. Everything that seems so clear is now not so clear. And we need to be careful. Beware that it does not confuse your mind. And finally, likewise, it tends our troubles to appease. Right? From the very beginning of literature, they said that poetry teaches and pleases. That was the two things it did. It was dulce et decorum, sweet and profitable for learning from, basically. Right? So this is what we do. Wow. Any other questions or something? And I've got books. I'll go back there and do the books if you want.
We're going to eat supper. We better go.
Oh, shall we go? Okay, good.
First of all, would you give Dr. Mark?
Thank you so much. And we'll be back in 5 weeks.
In 5 weeks, we'll be back.
Oh, great.
Spring Creek Barbecue, and they're open till 9. So that.
Oh, okay, we'll get out there, okay.
Indication of what we have if you'd like to go. Did you want to real quickly just tell us?
Oh, yeah, if you want any books, I can sign them. I've only got a few copies back. My new book is called The Myth Made Fact, and it looks at 50 Greek myths. It's a beautiful book. They're $30 on Amazon, but I sell those for $25. And then I've got The Myth Made Fact. I've got a book called The Dreaming Stone in which my kids become part of Greek mythology and learn that Jesus is the myth made fact. So they kind of go together. And those books are $10, but if you buy the two together, it'll just be $30, because I know $25 is a lot. Most of my books are cheaper, but it's normally $30. And I will sign them, so if anybody wants one, grab me back there before we head off. Let me take this off.